Mira and Harper Audio present The Act of Disappearing, a novel by Nathan Gower, performed by Cassandra Campbell and Ashley Klanac. For Rochelle, always. The photograph. All cameras capture the dead. The shutter opens, consumes the light, creates the image. An illusion, the ghost of some former self, what was but can never again be. The same person is never photographed twice. That's where we start, with a photograph. The end of one life, the beginning of another. The date printed on the back is July 4th, 1964. See the glossy surface of the front, the train bridge stretched across the Ohio River. Notice the brilliant bursts of fireworks against the fallen dusk, curtains of light threatening to drape the truss of the bridge. Now look down to the bottom right corner. See the tiny figure of a woman suspended in air, captured in the liminal space between life and death, falling to the black waters below. If you squint, you may even see what she holds in her arms, crushed against her chest with the shattering force of a mother's love, a swaddled baby. My name is Julia White. This is not my story. Part 1. The Rabbit Nest. 1. A dead body is a haunting thing. Every time I close my eyes, the onslaught of memory. Blue-white skin and twisted limbs. Bulbous eyes and purple lips. My mom's corpse lying stiff in her Poughkeepsie apartment. An empty pill bottle atop the note on her nightstand. Most days I can forget. But today, on the 3-year anniversary of her death, the swell of grief crushes my ribs, an inflating balloon that refuses to burst. Right now, I need my mom more than ever. I've been on mental health leave from work for the past few weeks, but now I'm back at the Sundowner Bar in Brooklyn. Inside the blue-black darkness is a salve against the hard light of the city. An hour into my shift, I have stirred myself into Negronis and Manhattans, shaken my regrets into gimlets and margaritas. Then some guy sporting an ironic fedora orders a dirty martini, Ryan's drink. I reach for the olive brine, but it's too much. Pinprick sweat gathers at my temples. I rush to the closet-sized bathroom behind the bar before my knees give out. Kneeling on the filthy terracotta floor tiles, I retch out the remnants of a blackberry smoothie, seedy and blood purple. I wipe the seat of the toilet with a paper towel, rinse my mouth, check my mascara. As soon as I get back to the bar, Myra pulls me aside, tucks my hair behind my ear. "Jules, honey, you don't have to be here," she says. Her voice holds the authority of a bar manager and the concern of a roommate. She's both, so it works. "Of course I do. I can barely afford to eat, let alone help Myra pay the rent. Sure, our little Crown Heights studio is Brooklyn cheap, but it's still Brooklyn." "Look at me, babe." Myra tilts my chin, catches my eyes. "It's okay if you're not ready. Give yourself time." The jaundiced glow of the bar cuts across her skin, splitting her into shadow and light. The silhouetted hook of her nose, the curvature of her ear. My brain morphs her face into a mirage of Ryan. I try to edge past her, but she won't budge. "I can't," I start, but I don't know what comes next. Myra pulls me into her, kisses my forehead. "We'll talk about it later. If you insist on staying, then get that guy another old-fashioned." She nods toward an old man sitting alone in my favorite corner of the bar. The dead zone, where you can drink in the shadows, hiding from the incessant hum of electric light. I serve the old-fashioned, but don't say anything. Nobody chooses to sit in the dead zone if they want to make small talk. By the time I come back to the other side of the counter, two emo-looking dudes are whisper-yelling about something. I swear to God, that has to be him, one of them says. His lip piercing is infected, cherry red, encrusted. My stomach lurches.
$20 says it isn't,
says the guy next to him. I try to ignore them, but I have to grab a jar of Luxardo cherries from under the counter, so I come into their orbit.
Hey, help us settle something, says Mr. Infection. It isn't a question, but a demand.
That guy over there, he says, stealing a glance at the man in the corner sipping his old-fashioned.
Is that who I think it is?
I want to tell them both that I'm not in the mood to referee their little boy battle, but I need tips, so. It would help if you tell me who you think he is, I say. He looks back one last time, then leans in close.
Johnathan Aster,
he says, just above a whisper. I have no idea who Johnathan Aster is. Well, that's not entirely true. His name floats in the ether of my consciousness the same way it does in most New Yorkers. The idea of him, his fame, his mythos, these things I know. But I couldn't pick him out of a lineup, and I certainly don't know why he would be ordering drinks in our seedy little hipster bar. Johnathan Aster probably has Soho penthouse money. I'm sure he could find a nice top-shelf bourbon in Manhattan without needing to cross the bridge. Okay, so I'm totally sorry about this, I say, serving the old man another drink. I gesture to the guys at the counter. But those two goth wannabes over there think you're Johnathan Aster, and they're not going to leave me alone until I find out. He eyes the two dudes on the other side of the bar, stirs his drink. I wait for him to answer. He doesn't. So, I mean, are you Johnathan Aster? The man studies my face, tilts his head. He leans forward out of the shadows, giving me the best look at him I've had all night. His iron gray hair curls at his ears, frames his angular face. His emerald eyes pop against his black suit, his silver tie. He looks to be pushing 70, maybe even older. But he's controlled, assured. He stands slowly, moves to the other side of the table, pulls out a chair.
Care to sit with me?
He says. He moves back to the other side, slides into his seat, takes a drink. Saliva rushes against my tongue the way it does just before I puke. The scorch of vomit threatens my throat, but I'm able to choke it back down. Whether he's Johnathan Aster is no matter. I know the type of man he is. I slide the chair back under the table, the legs hitting the metal pole underneath with a clank. And then what? I say.
Pardon?
I sit with you, and then what? You buy me a drink?
If you'd like.
So I just walk off my job and have a drink with you. And then, what's next? You tell me about your job, your money, your power. Maybe I reach across the table, brush my fingers over your knuckles. I cock my head, study his face. And then we have another drink, and another, and another. Pretty soon, you're hoping I forget that you're old enough to be my grandfather. Maybe I go home with you. Am I on the right track here?
You have quite an imagination,
he says. Maybe. I lean across the table, get right in his face. But look me in the eye and tell me you don't think you're three steps away from buying access to my body like it's just another cocktail. His eyes widen, an animal caught in a snare. He sips the dregs of his bourbon. The liquor shimmers on his upper lip. I start to leave, but no, I won't give him the satisfaction. I won't be made to feel crazy. Not tonight. Here's the thing, I say, locking eyes with the old man. I don't care who you are. I'm paid to serve you drinks, not to stroke your fragile masculinity.
You want to impress someone with your mystery and intrigue? Try those two fanboys at the bar.
Fair enough.
He holds a hand in front of him, a flag of surrender. I collect his empty rocks glass and turn to leave.
But could I ask you to do me one small favor?
I would ignore him, but then he adds one word, one that sends pinpricks down my spine.
Julia.
I freeze. Slowly, I turn back to him. How do you know my name? Who are you? He reaches into the leather messenger bag at his feet, pulls out a paperback book. When I see the cover, my face catches fire. I pull back the chair, take a seat.
I'm Johnathan Aster, he says,
placing a pen atop the book.
And if I've found the right woman, you're Julia White.
He flashes a smile, crinkling the skin around his eyes.
Would you do me the honor? Please.
He extends the pen to me, opens my book to the cover page. I can't say anything for an eternity, maybe 2 full minutes. So I sit, stunned, listening to one of the world's most famous art photographer drone on about how much he loves my little book.
It's remarkable, really, the blending of genres. I've never seen anything like it.
He thumbs through the dog-eared pages, then flips back to the note before the prologue. He raises a finger with a dramatic flair, reads my words back to me.
What follows is both real and imagined, history and myth, fact and fiction. The truth of this story belongs to me, and hopefully to my mother. Beyond that, I make no promises.
He looks at me with wonder in his eyes.
Simply marvelous, he says.
I'm lost in the moment when I feel a hand against my shoulder. I flinch. Sorry, love, says Myra. Didn't mean to scare you. Just checking to see if we need anything over here. She smiles at Aster, but then looks to me, cocks her eyebrow in a way that asks, is this creepy old man threatening you? We're good, I say, placing my hand on top of Myra's. Just give me a sec and I'll be back at the bar. The two goth fanboys are gawking, but I avoid their eyes. Myra waves me off. Take your time. She regards the book on the table. Who am I to keep you from your fans? She nudges my shoulder, walks away. I look back to Aster, but I don't know how to proceed. Listen, Mr. Aster, I start.
Johnathan, please.
I'm sorry about earlier. I stop, gesture around the room as if it holds an explanation. A man walks through the front of the bar, and for a split second, I think it's Ryan.
You're a woman who works in a dark room full of men, he says. No apologies needed.
Tears threaten my eyes. Grief pools inside me, an ink blot spreading through the chest.
So how about that drink?
Asks Aster.
Is that allowed?
I don't drink, I say reflexively. I realize only after I say the words that I am telling a half-truth.
A bartender who doesn't drink? Seems like a story waiting to be told.
I grab a cocktail napkin from the table, dab my eyes. Why are you really here? I ask. I mean, I'm flattered you've read my book. Really, I am. To be honest, I'm not even sure how you found it.
You can find anything if you know where to look.
Sure, but it's not exactly topping any Google searches. My little indie publisher says I've sold an astounding 376 copies. Instantly, I'm transported back to the night of the book launch last month. Memories skipping across my mind's reel, like jump cuts in a movie. My slackened face in the dirty bathroom mirror. Ryan's greedy hands across my chest. My hands pawing at his shirt. My bare back pressed against the cold concrete wall. hot breath against my ear, the tug and pull of dry skin. I try not to blink. My throat constricts. The fact that you've found a copy can't be a coincidence, I say, willing myself back to the present moment. Aster pushes the book in front of me, extends the pen in my direction once again. It's clear he isn't going to talk until I comply. I take the pen, swoop my signature below my printed name on the title page.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.